Hey guys, Ellen Prince here, back with Vinland Saga. This is the end portion of season one. I'm going to be reacting to the second opener and closer. I'm greatly enjoying this season. It's a good action-packed adventure, but shit's really going to start kicking off season two. And by kicking off, I mean slowing way the fuck down, because we have one of the best character arcs in any anime. At least in my opinion, from reading the manga, that's Farmland Saga. But, finally got a shirt that I think will work close enough for this. My white button-up is still on my chair. Along with my tan one, or not tan, gray one that I use for Dishonored and other shit. But that is gonna be it for me, at least here. So at this point, you all know the drill. Stuff down below, do it as you see fit. I'm gonna link where I get these videos from. And yeah. Without any further ado, let's get started. Finally, having to record my screen again after so long, it's just trying to make sure everything's working as it should. Right, this is the opener. And you know the drill, boat backwards, past, future, tomorrow. I love the stone carving in the background and my plan here, I'm gonna go over everything, you know, frame by frame, more or less, commenting on the cool shit I like about it. And but after that, gonna go back and actually listen to it again. But yeah, we've got our quote about boats here. Okay, I think this is a good. Like rowing a boat, we enter the future backwards. All we see are the scenes of the past, and no one can see the views of tomorrow. Funnily enough, with one of the games I've been playing with, TTRPG. We've been playing a game in Index Card RPG. I believe it's made by Runehammer. Really fucking love it. Check it out. It's a really versatile system, but our DM, he used a similar analogy for time travel stuff. Essentially, you know, like, I want to see if I can properly remember it, but the general idea is, you know, the events going past you are like a stick that's been dropped in the river way ahead. And, you know, you can, if you're on a bridge, you know, and drop it in, you see that happening, and then it just goes behind you. But you can run downstream, at least for how we were doing it. That's going to a different timeline, essentially. So the events still play out, but you can add another variable to the events by, for example, throwing another stick in. I'm just trying to figure out that whole, you know, how to properly solve a puzzle with that was really cool. You know, having to do multiple steps and go through multiple timelines to get those steps to happen was really fun. But yeah, I think this is a really good analogy in terms of like how to view the steady flow of time and all that. You know, it's unchanging, so on and so forth. But yeah, I really like the stone carving background here and this art style. I've been trying to find a way to emulate it for a while, but just haven't. You know, haven't found a proper Wait, okay, so we've got the Anglo-Saxon region, Franks, Saxony, the Rhineland, German territory, not sure what that says, the Lombards. Fuck it, I'll put music on, but the Norman style tapestries are really interesting when it comes to their art because it's, seeing the progression of like how art is done is really cool. And again, the transition from the tapestry to the live action, or the animated scene was, I really like that just as a constant transition point. And something else I really like are maps. Okay, Elba. I've heard that before somewhere, but it's not clicking. We've got the Swiss, the Dolmas here. That's gonna be the Swiss Alps, probably. Denmark, England, Wales, Scotland, the North Sea. This maps like that I really fucking love because it, at least if you know the history behind it, you can sort of infer everything else because all of these are common raiding routes that were used by Vikings, hidden in the Iberian Peninsula. There was a few raids in Italy, Rome, in Constantinople, which I believe was called Markland. Yeah, because it's what, the Markland sagas. But yeah, this, I like maps. Yeah, again, the transition point, with the green marks being settlements. I really like this. I've never been to Newfoundland or Labrador, so I can't tell you, how accurate this is to that area, specifically the fucking, what's it called, like the Lusignan Meadows settlement. It's the archaeological dig. In Norse settlement. In Canada. The An's Uch Meadows. Meadows Cove. First excavated in 1960s. Generally, Newfoundland, Labrador near St. Anthony. It's interesting that they chose the snake to be, behind Ascalon. Because I believe generally that's, essentially confirmed to be one of the symbols of Loki, trickster and all that. Which fits very well with him, with Ascalon. And you can even see the crown of Denmark hanging on his sword. That's some pretty good foreshadowing. It was cool seeing more of young Ascalon, because I believe that's, is that anime only? It's been a while since I read the manga. Speaking of really cool character work, seeing Canute go from, someone who I would regularly call princess, along with everyone else, to, someone who would become Canute the Great is really awesome. And the whole discussion of, like, love, with it being selfish and hypocritical and all that was, it's really cool. Just that whole discussion that was going on with Wilbur. Are I came up with a bit of alliteration for him, but I can't think of it now. Ragnar, he's really interesting as well. Yep. A lone battered wolf. Though, hey Wilbur, these two dipshits were. I really like them as characters. They're. Voice crack. They had a fun. Not. Why do I think of the word rivalry? But a camaraderie. And adding into that their discussion with Wilbur about, what is love? Don't hurt me no more. And how brotherly love can conflict with. Or it's. It can be conflated with different forms of love and is similar, but all that was very cool. Hey, Wilbur, Floki, Bjorn. This is just going to become a whole thing of me talking about characters I like, isn't it? Nope. Let's go back it down. I really like Rag, not Ragnar. Bjorn as a character. He was loyal to Askeladd as like to a fault. He trusted him. I went in way too deep with looking into what sort of mushroom he was eating. And yeah. The whole segment of the girl running from Ashdod's slaughter of the village was really, really interesting, at least in terms of how beautiful the art is. Thorkell. Thorkell is. I know I keep gushing over him, but he is easily one of my favorite characters. Like, in the last episode, he showed enough political guile and stuff to, help Knut properly rise to power with Ashlad's sacrifice. But, he's in it for the fight, and there's. We get to see more of him in the future, and I am happy about that. And this was a really cool fight, Gotta use your brain over Bron. Another thing I really like about this series, I know I'm just pausing back and forth. If you want to get my full thoughts on it, go back and watch one of the other episodes to just listen to it, but. That's a cool frog he has. I love the amount of chainmail that's being used. And, again with Thorkell, like, that is partially why, you couldn't just stab him in the chest or whatever, beyond the fact he's built like a brick shit house. And he probably has the same punching ability as a fucking grizzly bear. It's like a chainsaw attached to a, crane swinging about. But it. I love the use of chainmail and spears. Axes were really common as well, just because they're a good mix tool. You can cut down the door of a, that pretty young lass in the village you're raiding to steal all the shit in her house and, RPB the place. But, spears. I actually recently got. Come on. How the fuck am I gonna move this? Finally decided to buy a spear. It. Wanted to mess around with this a bit more before I, start using it in videos. But. Spears are the most common weapon found around the world for a reason. They're relatively easy, effective, and they're pokey. I'll have to go back earlier to see like the differences of Canute's face. And at least with going to a bit more analysis, like I feel this is, you know, a bit more of Thorfinn feeling like he's been left behind by them, you know, because they're going on to greater duties for kingdom and glory. Did I scratch the paint on the ceiling? Fuck. But, you know, going on for greater kingdom and glory, and he's just stuck. You know, he's running a fool's game that is revenge. Okay, back here. I think the difference might be the lines under the eyes. You know, that gives him more of a look you can take seriously. 'Cause doesn't, at least from this, it doesn't look like the light spots in his eyes have changed, you know, too much. I don't think, you know, it's added color. One day I'll figure it out. But yeah, I really like this opener. It's, in my opinion, it's not as good as the first one by, it's what, So Says the Prophet. Because I know they also do Paradox in Season 2, which I've been listening to a lot just on my own. I fucking love it. But yeah. I really like this. I think it's a well put together piece. The animation is amazing. And yeah. Let's move on to our next thing in the agenda. Alright, here we have Ending 2, Drown. I really liked Torches, along with the sketchy style it had. If I could fund a whole ass anime, I'd do it in that sketchy style. I love it as a stylistic choice. But yeah, let's just roll. Valkyries riding above to deliver warriors to Valhalla. And the Forest of Spears. I fucking love it. One thing I will... Yorm's Victor. Supply trains. Go to the other same car. This is why I don't watch fucking subtitled anime. I can't focus on reading and commenting on things at the same time. So what, that's their slaughter of Prince Canute's camp the first time. Going with sword and shield. Wilbur. Swain. Swain's really interesting because he is a brilliant man. But, you know, he just got hit by a sideline play that no one could have expected. Yeah, I love the sketchiness. I know I keep saying that, but... because all these panels are really cool to see come to life from the... anime, what the fuck, yeah, I guess that's a personal touch of whoever uploaded this, but yeah, this is, I know it's just repeating scenes we've seen in the anime, but I like the sketchiness of it. It gives a whole different feel from, you know, seeing like in the opener, how everything's actually like more. I want to keep using live action, so I'll just use that as the word, but you know what I'm trying to say. And the details of like the prows of the ship. I just love this so much. And before I do get to season two, I am gonna reread the Farmland arc. Because I want to be able to, you know, properly get a good comparing and contrasting. But yeah, believe that's gonna be it from me. You guys know the drill at this point. Stuff down below, do with it as you see fit. And yeah, thank you for watching this series. I know the whole thing is, you know, comment and engage, but I really do want to know, like, what are your guys' thoughts about season one of Vinland Saga? Because season two, hopefully, is going to win Anime of the Year for 2023. At least that's where I'm throwing my vote. But yeah. Just let me know your thoughts on everything. You know, like, if there's a show you want me to watch, your favorite or least favorite part of this, what is love? What makes a true warrior? Did Asrad truly care about any of his men? Again, you know the drill. Stuff down below, do with it as you see fit. And until next time, I'm Sven, and this is Elvin Prince, signing out.